The largest POW camp in this area is Fort Bowie. Do you know that there were those of German descent that were incarcerated even after the war was over? Now, we know the Japanese were rounded up and incarcerated and put in internment camps on the West Coast. But the Germans were also rounded up. Even if you were loyal to America, you were incarcerated in an internment camp right here in this county for 4 years longer than they incarcerated the Japanese. That means they lost their land. They lost their jobs. And it means that they were made a prisoner by their own nation just because of their ethnic background. That might suggest something about spiritual roots. Slavery was, of course, present here, and Texas supported slavery and supported the South. I've traveled across Texas and been to some of the most remote, desolate towns in this state. And I want to describe something they all have in common. Go to the county courthouse in Linden, Texas, way over the East Branch. And you will find that at the county courthouse, they have a big statue dedicated to the Confederacy and to the men who fought, the brave men who fought in the Confederacy, and they're continuing their cause. And I'm like, well, wait a minute. That war was over a long time ago. Why is that at your county courthouse? And almost every one of those places who have that, they're dead, and there's no economic life because there's a curse on the city. They need to understand how strongholds operate. Now, if I'm a pastor or I'm living there as a believer and I'm seeing the stronghold operating, you're going to take steps and use some artillery to take this out. Because your battle is not in the natural realm, it's in the spiritual realm. There's a strong man empowered over that region, empowered over that city, and that's why they're suffering. And look, legislators and councilmen may not have the answer for their town, but I know one in heaven who has the answer. And so God needs his people to rise up to the occasion no matter what nation or country we're in. When we see strongholds being empowered and they are causing oppression on God's people, the Bible says the curse causelessness does not come. There are reasons these kinds of things happen. And so it's up to the people of God to address them and deal with them. Example, I was living in Fresno, California. And I'm a prayer leader and a pastor, a spiritual leader. And came to my attention, they're having the largest reenactment of the Civil War in Kearney Park, Fresno, California. You can go there today. And I'm thinking, okay, I want to research this. Well, here's what I found out. California sent no federal troops to fight in the Civil War. So why are they having the largest reenactment of that shedding of innocent blood? I mean, that's just dumb. I'm sorry to use that terminology, but it's idiotic. Why would they permit that kind of, it's a reenactment of shedding blood. And the Bible says innocent blood on the land will curse the land and bring a curse on the people. But now my Bible talks about how to remove innocent blood. You got to go to the Word. Because answers are in the Word. Deuteronomy, I believe. Let me see if I can find that really quick. I think it's chapter 21. Yes, Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 1 says, if anyone is found slain, laying in the field of the land which the Lord your God has given you to possess, and it is not known who killed him, then the elders of your city and judges go out and measure the distance, find out what city's closest, and gather those who have spiritual authority, the elders. And then it tells you exactly what to pray. Look at verse 5. Then the priests and the sons of Levi come near, and the Lord your God has chosen them to minister. And verse 6. And that all the elders of that city nearest the slain man shall wash their hands over the heifer whose neck has been broken in the valley. In other words, they made a sacrifice, and then they, for the sin that has defiled the land, they poured water over their hands, over the heifer, and then they prayed this. It tells you the exact prayer to pray to remove innocent blood guilt off the land. Our hands have not shed this blood, nor have our eyes seen it. Provide atonement, O Lord, for your people. How many believe the word of God then is still the word of God today? Amen. So now I happen to also know that if you're going to have authority in the land, Native Americans have first authority in the land. God placed them here. They were here as caretakers for the land. Europeans came in and made treaties with them. Over 550 treaties were made in America, and all of them were broken. Yes. And that broken covenant on the land defiled the land as well. You want to redeem the land? You better include First Nations. So I rounded up some First Nations people who live in Fresno, California. And so we went, we had some worship, we prayed to God, and as one with spiritual authority, along with their authority, we declared that this reenactment was not welcome on the land, and we're rejecting identification with the shedding of innocent blood and with violence and murder, and that's not welcome in Fresno, California. And then we did a prophetic act. We took water. We read this scripture right here, that our hands have not shed this blood, neither have our eyes seen it, Lord. Provide an atonement. We poured water over our hands onto this land where they're reenacting this curse. You know what happened? It started raining inside the park, but didn't rain outside the park. I mean, the park got wet. But the moment you drive out of the park, the ground was dry. God was cleansing that land because his people came in his name and in his authority and dealt with the defilement on the land, and God removed the defilement. Listen, we have to understand we have supernatural authority in this realm, and we've got to start using it. And we don't just lay back and say, well, it's so terrible the enemy came in and wreaked havoc. Listen, let me tell you about a woman who was using her advanced weaponry. In Oklahoma, Marge and I lived there for about 18 months. In Oklahoma, they have lots of these tornadoes that come through. They got the Tornado Alley thing going. I wouldn't recommend living in Tornado Alley, but there's some folks who do. And so we got to watch on TV, you know, they're describing these tornadoes are coming to this town, and they've got the tornado chasers, you know, and they're out in their four-wheel drives, and they're chasing the storms and trying to record it, and here's a cameraman, and you can see this funnel cloud is coming to this town, and, you know, most people are in their, a lot of the folks who live there, they have cellars, you know, they have storm shelters. And they're reinforced with concrete, and they get into their little bunker, their storm shelter, and they bunker down. But the reporter was fascinated because here's a 70-year-old lady, and she's standing out here, and she's shouting at the cloud. And so here comes the reporter. Now, you see the reporter, he got on the hat, and he's holding the hat, and he got the microphone, and his raincoat's flapping out there in the breeze, and he's braving it, you know, to catch the story. And lady, what are you doing out here, lady? And when he gets up there close enough, he can hear her praying. Only she's not praying natural. She's praying in the spirit. And so the reporter, not thinking about his audience, says, oh my goodness, this woman's praying in tongues. She's using advanced weaponry. And she's shouting at this cloud. And you know what? The cloud lifts up and moves and goes around her farm and around everybody in her town because one woman had a weapon. Now, we've learned because we live there that these things are very useful. You know, God was the first one to use one of these in Exodus chapter 19 to summon the people and to send forth his word and to rally the army and to release the army. And so we learned that whenever there was a bad storm coming at us in Oklahoma, Mark, you get this thing out and blow it and command the thing to leave, and it would leave. Advanced weaponry. Shofar is what it's called. Ram's horn, shofar. And so the other night we were having a bad storm here, and I got a text from Josh. He said, is Margie blowing her shofar yet? I said, no, but she's about to. And so she blew it, and the storm got angrier. How many know that storms can come from the devil?
Yes.
Because they bring destruction. Now, that made me mad. You go listen to my wife. So I went out there and blew it and took authority. Told him, you will leave. You will not come down on this city. You will not do any damage on this city. You're not going to start any fires with it. In fact, you stop that lightning and you get out of this territory and out of my region now. Blew this thing about 3 times, and within 5 minutes, the thing was lifting. We have to know our authority and our weapons and how to use them. God will honor it, and the devil has to listen. Now, I have to tell you this. He knows whether or not you believe in your authority and that you have faith. And if you don't, he'll just laugh at you. So we have to learn how to operate in our supernatural faith and with our weapons. Amen? So I've got some, I want to introduce you to some supernatural advanced weapons. And they're all found pretty much in Matthew chapter 8. It says in 2 Corinthians 10, 4 and 5, the weapons of our warfare are mighty, not carnal, for the pulling down of strongholds. So let's go to Matthew chapter 8 and look at some advanced weaponry. I like seeing things through the military model, if you will, because I spent about 9 years in the Marines, and so I know how to look through that paradigm. So here we are in Matthew chapter 8, and I want you to look at verse 8. This is a story about the centurion, and he would like to have a paralyzed servant who's being tormented healed. And this story appeals in several places. And one of the places it appears, the leaders of the local synagogue go to Christ and say, you know, he's a good man. He's a Gentile, but he's a good man. Now, centurion would have been a man that would have been over 100. He ruled over 100 troops. So he was a centurion. But he was also somebody who loved God and honored God. And he actually used his men to build a synagogue for the religious leaders. And so they went. Now, most of the religious leaders hated, because they wanted to honor this man who was asking for help for a dying servant who was precious and valuable to him. The religious leaders humbled themselves and they went to Yeshua and they said, well, he has blessed our nation. He built us a synagogue. He's a worthy man. We think you ought to honor his request. Now, wait a minute. You want to honor his request one day and ask him to heal somebody one day and crucify him the next? That's how religion is. And so then the word came, Yeshua said, okay, I'll do it. I'll go with you. So they headed out for the man's house. And so the man sent word to him, to Christ, and he said this, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this one, go, and he goes. And then another one, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this. And he does it. And when Christ heard it, he marveled and said to those who were following, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith anywhere in Israel. He understood that speaking a word was a weapon. If you speak the word of God, and speak a word for God, it's a weapon. But it must be spoken in faith. And in this case, it was a declaration. Number two, prayer is a weapon when used as a declaration. Because that's what we see here. You understand there's a time for petition. But if you want to see victory over your enemy, you need to be operating in declaration. And most times in churches that I've been in, petitions really are confessions of unbelief. Let me explain. Well, Father, we're asking that you would heal that person that's in the hospital. We know that you can. We're hoping you will, but we're doubting that you will. You know what I'm talking about? Have you heard those kind of prayers? Look, he said, come confidently and boldly before the throne of grace to receive grace and mercy in time of need. Come boldly. Why? Because we trust in his word. We believe his word will not return void. We're releasing his word. We're going to do it with boldness. We're going to do it believing that God said it, he meant it, and he'll back it up. Amen. There's no sense praying if you're not going to do that. Don't be praying prayers of defeat. God wants us to pray prayers of victory. And we understand he's going to answer it whatever way he wants, but he says, I want you to have faith. Come confidently and boldly before my throne of grace. That's in Hebrews 4:16. Number three, touching releases the anointing of the weapon through the laying on of hands. So look at Matthew chapter 8, verse 15. Capernaum. There was a temple there where Christ healed a man with a withered hand. But Peter's mother-in-law was there. And so when our group was recently in Israel, we went there and they've built, you know, this thing over the top of Peter's mother-in-law's house. But you can see the remnants of it. Remnants of an old synagogue is there. It's right there by the Sea of Galilee. Beautiful place. We were able to visit there. But Christ came there. Probably was invited to dine or eat with them to Peter's house, and there's the mother-in-law lying sick with a fever. So in verse 15, he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and made dinner. That was a good dinner to celebrate. But I don't want you to miss this. The touching or the laying on of hands was how the anointing of God was transferred. When you go set somebody aside for ministry, you lay hands on them. Why? Because the anointing that God has put in you when released in authority causes that anointing to go into the person that you're praying for. And if you're praying a word of healing, then the anointing of healing from you and the faith that you're carrying for healing goes from you to that person. All he had to do was touch your hand. His anointing went into her. And when the woman touched the hem of his garment, he said, I feel that virtue went out of me. Who touched me? They said, well, Master, what do you say, who touched me? People have been bumping into you all day in this crowd. Because this touch was different. Virtue went out of me. The anointing went forth out of me. I felt it. I've been with people I've prayed for. I feel the anointing go out. I feel the touch of God released, and I know God did something. All of us carry anointing, but we need to feed it. And the way you feed the anointing is to be in his word and in prayer and praying in the spirit and believing his word for what he says, and then God builds you up to begin to act on the faith that you have and the word that you have in you, and when you release it, an anointing comes forth. And you'll see things happen for folks. Four, healing and deliverance is a weapon when released by faith. Look at verse 16. And one evening, now here's what happened. After Peter's mother-in-law got healed, word got out. Isn't that's just mind-boggling. A woman got healed of a fever. I mean, you know, she didn't have leprosy. She wasn't raised from the dead. Didn't have cancer. She just had a fever. It was so unusual that somebody would get healed by faith that the whole community and surrounding area, droves and droves of people began to show up for healing because there had been no healing anywhere. You know, it's difficult to live in a place where people are oppressed by the devil, they're sick, they're hurting, and there's no healing except for the local doctor, and he runs out of medicines that work, and there's no hope for you. You got Alzheimer's, there's no hope for you. That's the leprosy of today. You got COPD and your lungs are shot, no hope for you. Terminal cancer, stage 4, spread to the bone, there's no hope for you. Hey, listen, why are we putting all our hope in doctors? Well, we got a physician in heaven who has the medications that men don't have here. So folks got excited. They heard this fever had gotten healed. Word got out, and so all kinds of people are showing up. Look at verse 16. And when evening had come, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed. By the way, that word possessed is not the right translation. There's no word for possession. It's demonized. And there's various levels of being demonized. A person can be harassed or attacked or demonized and not possessed by the devil, but they're being attacked by the devil. And that's very common. And so it says here, they brought to him many who were, let's say, demonized. He cast out the spirits with a word and healed all the sick. And so here, most of the people who had sickness also had spirits that were attacking them, and he had to drive out or drive away the harassing demons along with the sickness. Very often when you pray with people who have cancer, there's a spirit of cancer oppressing them. Arthritis, all kinds of different diseases where the enemy, sometimes it's generational. There are sicknesses that operate through a generational line, like diabetes. And so the enemy has the right to perpetuate them because they got started through iniquity in the family line. And so the enemy will try to perpetuate that sickness and oppress each generation. So when you're ministering to somebody who's being demonized, attacked, harassed, or oppressed, you not only have to speak to the disease, you need to speak to the spirit behind it. Satan, I address you in the name of Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, and I tell you, spirit of cancer, you leave this body. You release them. Usually I pray with the person first and I have them come to the cross, because it says in Galatians 3:13 that cursed is everyone who hung on a tree, and that Christ took our curses to the cross. So I have the person pray. Father, forgive my forefathers for their iniquities, because the iniquities passed on to the third and fourth generation. But it also says in Galatians 3:29, we have a new inheritance through Christ to Abraham's seed, and we become an heir to all the promises made to Abraham. So I'm going to leave my curses on the tree. I'm going to come on down through Christ Yeshua, and I'm going to enter in and claim all of the inheritance that comes from Abraham and the promises of Abraham I'm grafted in. And I'm going to call those forth not only on me, on my family line, on my family lineage, and I'm going to declare that all the curses have to stop over my family. We have a new inheritance. We have a new lineage because we've been to the tree. Listen, we can evoke that over our family line. What kind of things have been tracking your family line? Bring them to the cross. Authority is a weapon. Look at chapter Matthew 8:26. Now here, they're having a storm. They ministered all day. They're weary. And so Christ commands them to depart to go to the other side of the lake in verse 18. So they get on the boat, they're going to the other side of the lake. And it says a great storm arises on the boat in verse 23 and 24. But Christ, he's asleep in the boat. Is he worried about the storm? No, he's asleep in the boat. I think he's also testing the disciples, because he wants them to understand they have authority to speak to the storm and the problem. So he's like, I'm taking the time out. I'm going to rest up. But they're freaked out. I mean, we're going to drown. So they're calling out, Master, Master, don't you care? We're going to perish out here. We're fishermen. We know what it means to be out here in a bad storm and covered with waves. And we're going to perish. We're going to go down. Look at verse 25. His disciples came to him, awoke him, saying, Lord, save us. We're perishing. Can you just see Christ? He looks at them, and he's got this sad look on his face. It's almost like he wants to just kind of roll his eyes. You know, it's like, when are you guys going to get it? And so he says, why are you fearful, O you of little faith? And then he rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was great calm. He expected them to do that. He expects you and me to do that. We have the same faith. They didn't even have the Holy Spirit, but he said, in my name, you can still do it. Holy Spirit hadn't fallen yet. We got more than they had. He still said, oh, you little faith, why aren't you ruling in my name and in authority and taking care of things, taking care of business on earth? Why aren't you mobilizing my army and speaking into the darkness and dealing with the darkness? I've given you my name. What else do you need? Now I've given you my spirit. Wow. Just a note, on the Sea of Galilee when we were recently in Israel, and everywhere we partook covenant, praying over protection of covenants that God made with Jacob, Isaac, Abraham in the land, it rained. It was a sign of God's blessing. And so we got ready to get on the boat, and I sensed the Holy Spirit saying to me, we went on the Daniel boat, which he's a messianic believer, and he plays Christian music, messianic music, on his boat sailing around on the Sea of Galilee. Imagine you spending 45 minutes sailing around on the Sea of Galilee worshiping the Lord. And I heard the Lord say, buy communion. And I was told by somebody else, well, if they have other people on the boat, they probably won't let you take it. But the Lord said, buy communion. So I bought me a loaf of bread and some grape juice and took it on there and asked permission. So he just had me check with the people on the boat. He said, we're thinking about having communion out here. What a beautiful place to do it. How did I word that? Is everybody all right with joining in? This is a great time to worship God. Amen. And everybody went, yeah. So then we got an agreement. It happened on the boat. We took communion. It rained. Immediately, a great storm and a wind came upon the Galilee for us. Only we weren't frightened. We were excited because we're reliving the story. You know what I mean? The wind's coming up. The wave, the boats are rocking. And you know what? Margie and whoever is out there, and they're dancing and shouting. And it's cold. It happened to be cold this time when we were in Israel. And so we're wet and we're cold, but we don't care. We're on the Sea of Galilee and we're worshiping God. We discovered that the song Oceans that was recorded by Hillsongs was recorded on his boat. A version of it, yeah. So we're excited to identify with Christ out there in the Sea of Galilee and the disciples. So now, what happened when they came to the other side after he calmed the storm is they met a man who was a demon-possessed, demoniac, in verse 28. And when he had come to the other side of to the country of Gerasenes, there met him two demon-possessed men coming out of tombs, exceedingly fierce, so that no one could pass by them. Now, I'm not going to read all of it, but basically, one of the demon-possessed men comes running to Yeshua and to ask for help, but then the demon interferes and says, why are you here? We know who you are. Have you come here to torment us before our time? Christ took authority over them and said, who are you? And they identified themselves as being legion. A legion is 1,000. So this man had 1,000 demons. And they begged him to allow them to go into the pigs. And so he said, go. And you know what they did? They drove all of the herd of pigs into the ocean and they drowned them. Now you should look at this and say, well, why would God do that? Because it made the farmers mad. And when they heard, they came out and found out that this demoniac has been healed. He's clothed and in his right mind. But they're not excited about that. They're only looking at the fact that they lost their livelihood and their herd of pigs is gone. And so they said, please leave here. You've caused us enough loss already. We don't care about the demoniac. Get out of here. Let me tell you why he allowed the destruction of the pigs. The farmers were Jews. They were forbidden to touch or having anything to do with hogs. They were unclean. And so They were raising these pigs to be sacrificed at the pagan temples. Temple of Zeus, Temple of Pan, some of the other pagan temples. Because they were making money off of the pagan worshipers. And this is you know, God's way of rebuking them. How dare you make a living off encouraging people to worship other gods? But then the man who was healed wanted to go with Christ, and he said, no, I want you to go back and tell your people the great things that the Lord's done for you. Give your testimony. He became the first evangelist in that region. And as a result, later, when Christ returned, there was a great harvest and a great reaping of souls, and a church built there, by the way, because this evangelist went and told them how it was that he was delivered. And I'm sure he talked about, this was my life. I lived in tombs. I cut myself. I cried night and day. I was terrorized until a voice pierced my darkness and set my mind free. And I'm here to glorify him, because if he could deliver me, imagine what he could do for you. He preached it. And that whole region turned to Christ as a result. So deliverance is a weapon when done by faith. Now, folks, look. On any of these weapons, you have to believe God will do it in order to use the weapon. And so if you're praying with somebody that is having a harassment, you have to believe, if you take authority over that spirit and demand that it leave and do battle, that God's going to give you victory. The angels will come and God will back you up. The angels aren't going to let the... Look, if you're doing deliverance, let me give you a couple tips. You bind the thing and tell it. You may not act out. You may not harm this person or anybody here. You're bound. And you only speak as the Holy Spirit allows you to speak, and I allow you to speak. You understand? You're bound. You take authority in the way that they know that you have authority and understand who you are. They won't play with you if you do. They won't act out. They won't do weird stuff like on some of the movies, because you're bounding them. And when you bind them, the angels of God move in and they bind them. So you don't allow nonsense when you're dealing with deliverance. Amen? Faith is a weapon that releases all other weapons. You ever thought of faith as a weapon? It is. That's why it says in Mark 11, 23 and 24, if you have the faith of a mustard seed and you say to this mountain, be ye removed and cast into the sea, it must go. Faith is a weapon. Prophesying with declarations of faith is a weapon. The centurion was prophesying when he was saying, as I send my men and command them, you're able to send your word and command it, and it will be accomplished. It will happen. He was prophesying. And so, you know, immediately Yeshua said, according to your faith, it's done, man. It's done. You saw it. You prophesied it. Faith is declaring that which is not as if it is, and that's prophesying. So we're going to add definition to faith. You've heard that, haven't you? From Hebrews. That faith is declaring that which is not as if it is. And also Romans 4:17. But in declaring that which is not as if it is, you're prophesying. When God gives you a word of knowledge for somebody and you declare it, you're prophesying. So I always ask God when I'm getting ready to pray for somebody, Lord, what do I pray? Because I'd like to have a word of knowledge. It's awesome. When you use a word of knowledge, it'll immediately release what it's speaking to. One time when God told me what I was praying for, an 8-year-old girl that had a tumor under her arm the size of a baseball, and they were going to remove it, but she had terrible asthma, and her grandmother had died of asthma, and the mom was terrified that if her baby went into surgery, she'd die like her mom because of complications. When they put you under with anesthetic, it can compromise your lungs and cause congestion. Well, if you have asthma and your lungs are already compromised, putting you out like that can be very risky. And so she was talking to the doctor, the anesthesiologist, about her concern. And I'm sitting there, and the little girl is over here, and the Lord said, go take authority over asthma and tell it to leave. I'm like, no shouting, no jumping up and down. I got a key given to me from heaven, and heaven says, speak this. So I just went over to the little girl and I said, all right, asthma's leaving you now. Asthma, you're going. And it's not coming back. You're going to be all right. I tell asthma, go out, leave down. Jesus' name, amen. Nobody heard me except for the little girl. But later I told the mom what had happened. You know, she had no problems with her surgery. She recovered fine. And then the mom told me, Pastor's like what you said. The asthma left and it's never come back. That's a word of knowledge. They're precious. We ought to ask for them. It's a weapon. Because when God tells you specifically something to say or speak or do, he'll back it up. I love to operate in Rhema, which is the revealed word of God. Amen? Weapons. Advanced weaponry. Praying in the Spirit is a weapon. We're talking about that this morning. Jude. The little book of Jude only has one chapter right before Revelation. It's all the way down to the end. I usually pass it and wind up in Revelation. I have to go back to it. And so we would say Jude 1, verse 20. And it says, but you, beloved. You know, I've got to throw in what goes before it because it gives you a contrast. Verse 18, it says, how they told you that there would be mockers in the last days who would walk according to their ungodly lust. These are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the Spirit. But you're different. Beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit and keeping yourselves in the love of God. Praying in the Holy Ghost releases not only the Spirit, but the love of God. It releases the anointing. I don't know if you've experienced this, but when you're ministering, if you pray a little bit in the Spirit, immediately the anointing will increase. Sometimes when I'm ministering at the altar and I'm not feeling the breakthrough, I'll just shift into praying in the Spirit for a bit. And usually what happens is a word of knowledge will come, or the authority increases to where the breakthrough happens. So it is a weapon, and we need to learn how to pray in the Spirit and how to use it so that we're not always just kind of flowing out of our mind and out of the natural. Now, I want you to know that everything we see in the New Testament is an application of something from the Old Testament. So where does tongues come from the Old Testament? Well, the Hebrew word for prayer, one of the Hebrew words for prayer is palal. P-A-L-A-L, and it's here on your sheet. And it simply means prayer in the Hebrew. But the letters are the pe, which means to speak, and the lamed, which is tongue of authority. And it, the lamed appears twice. So the literal meaning of the Hebrew for pray is to speak with the tongue of tongues and authority. There's tongues in Hebrew. Come on. To speak with the tongue of tongues in authority. And then when the Holy Ghost gets poured out at Pentecost, you really begin to see it. It releases authority when you do it, amen? Now there's a picture on your sheet of the soldier in Ephesians chapter 6. When Paul talks about put on the whole armor of God, that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, this is prophetic armor. It's a picture of a Roman soldier, and every area of the body that's covered is an area of weakness, and every piece of the armor represents Christ, and so you're praying Christ over your weaknesses and over your vulnerability, and when you pray him on and his armor on, you can stand against the wiles of the devil. That's what it's talking about. Helmet of salvation is the mind of Christ over your mind. Breastplate represents the, you know, the heart and lungs being protected. It's the his righteousness being prayed over you to protect your spiritual life. The belt of truth not only went around the waist, that belt went all the way down from the waist to the knee. The belt had a skirt that went with it. And so when they made covenants, they would put their hand on the inner thigh to swear the covenant. It was also considered the seat of the motions. So when they were praying on the belt of truth, they were saying, Lord, protect all of my covenants, my emotions, and all my relationships. May they be according to your truth. We're talking about praying on the arm. Look, if you're going to go into battle and you're in the army, you got to put on your armament, your warfare. You got your helmet, you got your flak jacket, you know, your cartridge belt and your M16 rifle and your boots. You don't go into combat unless you're dressed for combat. So then it goes on to say the shield of faith. Now, the shield of this picture is too small. That shield covered most of the body. And they had clips on them where you could actually clip your shield with your neighbor, and you could have like a wall of defense as you're marching into battle with your shields in unity and locked together. And then the sword of the Spirit, which I want to come to, tells us in Ephesians that the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. W-O-R-D. That's the primary offensive weapon, is the sword. But if you look up W-O-R-D here, it's not Logos. If you look up W-O-R-D here, it's Rhema, which means revealed truth from God. God telling you what to speak, what to do, how to use the Logos, and then he backs it up. It's Rhema. And so we have to, Christians, beloved, we have to learn how to hear from God and how the Holy Spirit direct the battle and speak to us so we know what to say and do. That's Rhema. And that's putting the sword of God in your hand. I'm talking about advanced weaponry. And then there's the shoes of peace. Now, these shoes were to keep them from slipping and falling. They had spikes on them. You know, the NFL football players are not the first one to discover spikes on the shoes. The Roman soldier wore them, and these spikes could be up to 2.5 inches long. And not only did they help them when they're fighting uphill against the enemy, if you fall on your face in front of your enemy, you're dead. But they were also a weapon. If the enemy's under your feet and you got spikes on your shoes, you're going to crush him. And the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2 that God has raised us to sit in Christ in heavenly places, and all powers and principalities are placed beneath our feet. And if we're wearing the armor of God and the enemy's under our feet, we're going to stomp on him. Because we got a weapon on our feet. And then it's not listed in Ephesians 6, but I believe it's referred to. The lance of intercession, because Paul says in Ephesians 6:18, pray always in the Spirit. You see, prayer strikes the enemy while he's still a long way away before he gets into your face for hand-to-hand combat. And the lance was like that. It's bigger than a sword, you know, it's a spear. You could throw the lance and strike the enemy while he was still a long way off. I believe intercessory prayer is the lance of intercession. That's a part of the weaponry of that soldier you see in Ephesians 6. Are you dressed for battle, my friends? Are you using the advanced weaponry by faith? Are you taking on the battles? I'm going to close with this thought. When we're in Israel, we're at Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi is the setting of where Matthew chapter 16 took place, where Christ says to the disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" And Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And he said, the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, Peter. And I'm paraphrasing. On this, you are, Peter, the little rock. But upon this greater rock of my confession, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, if you go to Caesarea Philippi, and we were there, they had a temple to Zeus, a temple to Pan, several temples there. And they made sacrifices to their gods, and they had niches, and the niches are still on the wall of the cliff. And so it was a place where all the gods were at. And the pagans who worshipped believed that it was a gateway to hell. Because they could throw people in. If you went through the Temple of Pan, there was a big hole in the ground where water came out. And if you threw a person in there and no blood bubbled up, then the sacrifice was accepted. If blood bubbled up, the sacrifice was rejected. It was considered a gate of hell. So here's Christ. He's standing in front of the gateways of hell. He's there to challenge them. And he's basically saying, here's your weapon. Tell them who I am and take them down. And so they made the confession there today, and there's no more temples there. They're gone. He was actually saying to them, wherever you find the gates of hell, challenge them. They won't prevail against the gates of my church, but the gates of my church is not supposed to tolerate them. You take them down when you see them, and the weapon I'm giving you is my name. Wow. Yeshua HaMashiach. God understands who we mean when we say Jesus. But the name Jesus did not exist then. It didn't exist until 1629 in the third translation of the King James Bible. The name used for him was Yeshua. The word Yah is God. Shua is deliverer. The word Yeshua means God who delivers. And he could deliver you from any gate of hell. Any sickness, any storm, any assignment of hell. The God who delivers still shows up today. Yeshua. Now, Jesus has become a term of endearment, and I have to say to you that God has honored the use of the name because he knows who we mean. But I believe he's calling us back to complete truth and complete restoration of his kingdom and his word. And sometimes I use the name of Jesus because I've used it all my life. God knows who I mean. But if you want real authority, use the name that carries authority, which is the name he said, in my name. With this revelation, you'll take down the gates. Because you'll see greater authority when you do. So no condemnation here. God understands that things are in the process of restoration. Amen. I'm glad to learn about advanced weaponry. Amen. And by faith, God wants us to believe that we can do all of these things, not just the clergy. Let me say something. The devil wants us to be afraid of him. But the weakest Christian dressed in the armor of Christ is more than a match for all the demons of hell. Because they were defeated on a cross. Colossians chapter 2 verse 15 says, He made a public triumph over them at the cross. He defeated them. And the imagery there is that whenever a king conquered another king in his army, the defeated army was forced to march in front of the conquering king and acknowledge the superiority of the God of that king. And so what it says in Colossians 2:15 is, Christ Yeshua made a public spectacle of the devil and all of his army angels and made them to march in front of his face and acknowledge their defeat. I've dealt with demons where I've said, you were at the cross and you will admit you were there. Yes. And you will admit you were defeated. I don't want to. No, you will admit it. I was there. Okay, now you're defeated. You get out. It's a weapon. The weakest Christians, that include everybody here? If you're a believer in Christ, I don't care how strong you are. We're not all like Arnold Schwarzenegger spiritually. You know, we're not these big old bodybuilder guys with big abs and stuff. Some of us are just learning what it means to really walk in faith. But what God wants you to know today, dressed in him. You know, let's suppose that you're in King Arthur's day. And you got on King Arthur's armor, and you're riding his horse, and you come riding into town. Who do they see coming? King Arthur. You're wearing the armor of Christ. Who does the devil see coming? Christ. I've learned to put on the armor of God every day, because we're going to have battles every day, and we should. But then you act like you're wearing that armor. Devil, you listen to me. I've even challenged the spirit when I'm doing deliverance. Look at me, spirit. Who do you see? I see Christ. Of course you do, because I'm in him and he's in me, and I'm speaking his word, and you're going to obey in his name. So right now, today, we're going to end our session by praying on the armor of God for this week. And you're going to have victory this week. And the devil, when he comes to play games with you, he's going to see Christ. Father God, right now, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, I pray on the belt of truth that holds together all of the pieces of armor over our covenants, our relationships. Fear, you loose the people of God and go out, because truth is coming in, the truth of Christ, and there's no place in the truth of Christ for fear, because he defeated it on the cross. And I call, Father, for the breastplate of righteousness, cover our spiritual life and lungs and heart, and protect the breath of the soul in our prayer life, God, and let us stand before the Father in your righteousness. Father, give us the helmet of salvation that will protect our minds, our thoughts against the bombardments and voices of the enemy and accusations of the enemy. We rebuke every accusation and cast it down and put on the mind of Christ today with the helmet. Come on now, we're praying on advanced weapons. And Father, we thank you that we're taking up the shield of faith that extinguishes the fiery darts of the enemy, anointed with the water of the word and the spirit. And Lord, we're taking in the right hand the sword of the spirit, which is Rhema, and declaring revelation is coming my way this week. I'm going to have Rhema from heaven. God's going to direct from now on. And I'm walking in the gospel shoes of peace in the name and authority of Christ Yeshua. And I'm walking in his victory and in his shalom. Nothing's missing. Nothing's broken. I'm walking in him. I'm dressed in the armor of the living God. And devil, you're defeated. Out of every life here today. And I announce from heaven that there's victory in everyone here. They're going to walk in victory this week and in the armor of the living God. Thank you for your victory today. Thank you, Father, for giving us Rhema now to apply what we've heard. We want to move on from the elementary basic weapons to take a hold of the advanced weapons, and we want to be armed and dangerous to the kingdom of darkness and see it defeated this week in our lives. Oh, God, even in nations. In Christ's name, Yeshua's name we pray. Amen and hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Well, we did the altar call together while you were in your seats. If y'all have any needs, though, don't hesitate to come up and tell me what they are. We don't want anybody going home that has any burden or any concern. If you have a need, come on up and tell me. We'll pray over it. But we're declaring we have our victory. Amen. We have a need. Spirit of depression needs to go.